Testing?
Yeah. Are you ready? Are you ready? Okay. Did everyone take note of the code for the conference? Or those interested, at least? Hello? Anyone? Okay, so I want to volunteer. I was here in the room, sorry, but I have really bad attention. I was working on some code. So I want a volunteer to explain me what Jorge did in the morning. What did you learn? I'm really good at appointing volunteers as well. Ten, nine. We have one there.
We started off with predicting from what we did yesterday on behavior callbacks and carried on with controllers. Once we finished controllers, we went on to security and CSR bits. Then we came on to the behavior with that templates, elements, and the differences between blocks and elements. And then we finally ended up with PHP unit and unit testing.
Okay, that was a lot. So, behaviors, callbacks, controllers, views, all the view layer, view blocks, elements, helpers, and unit testing. So he left, and you were doing some unit tests. Is that correct? What was the unit test about? What did you test? Can someone explain?
Just a find.
Just a find. Find method. Okay. So Jorge as well explained the difference between the different asserts in PHP unit? Nope. Okay. So PHP unit has multiple different ways of asserting or testing that a result is what you expected. Here are a few that you will commonly use. One is assert empty. It's basically asserting that a variable is empty. You know what empty is in PHP? Mostly everything. assert equals, which is if a variable is equals with double equal sign to another variable, it's not triple equal sign. There's another one that is not here listed. It's called assert same. It will use triple equal sign. There's assert true, there is assert false. Mostly for any of the methods here that you see in this list, there is a counterpart called not that thing. For example, assert not empty, assert not equals. In the case of assert not true, it would be assert false, assert not contains, and assert count. Not count wouldn't make sense. Also, PHP unit has comments that do things. What? So, yeah, you can comment the function with expected exception and expected exception message, and you can test that a function that you are calling will throw an exception and it will contain a specific exception message. There are plenty more assertions and plenty more comments that you can put in your functions. For example, data provider, you can create groups, you can capture the output of a function if it echoes. There's plenty more. You will probably need a specialized PHP unit course to cover everything. He's not in the room, but Chris Harches, he has a book. It covers pretty much everything that is to know on PHP unit. Chris Harches. Oh, yeah. He did. So, before going step forward, I want you to check out in Git, the advanced branch. I just merged everything that Jorge did this morning into the advanced branch, and I pushed it. So you have the method that I created yesterday. Remember on my crazy finders? You probably do. It's here. I want you to pick a finder. That's not nice, Larry. So I want you to pick a finder. Could be most of them are in questions table. And I want you to create a unit test for that finder. Using any of these methods here, assert empty, assert equal, assert true, assert count. That's the first assignment. And the second one is, use another finder, but you have a challenge for this one. What Jorge has been doing so far is a bit more than unit testing. He's basically doing integration tests for the model because he hits the database. Which is actually a good idea most of the time. But if you just want to test purely unit test style, the challenge for you is pick another other finder, and you're not allowed to execute the query, and you must test that what you, the query, the how the query was built is exactly how you expected it to be built. So pick two, I would personally pick the first two, Boolean question and this one, find by user. If you were seeing what I just did, I just changed the fixture a bit to have more relevant data for my testings. There are plenty of ways of how you can configure a fixture. KPHP goes the easy way, I would say. We just manage our fixtures using text files. It goes well. If you don't have a ever-changing schema, and if you think in advance how your data would look like, or how it should kind of work. So I would recommend to spend the time, if you're into testing, try to spend some time into creating meaningful fixtures. The lorem ipsum text is fine for kind of getting started, but try to make them meaningful. So you can actually, when you read the test, you understand what is happening. And it's not just, garbage testing or just like a foobar testing. There's another way of managing the fixtures. I'll not cover that. It's a bit more advanced, which is changing or modifying the class itself. So you can actually use fixtures from other places. For example, you could import records for an external database, or you could load a SQL file, or you could just ping some cache system and load from it, etc. The fixture system is quite flexible to allow you not using only these arrays, but whatever other system, if you fancy that. So this is the answer for the first challenge. It has a mistake, I know it's on purpose. Not sure if you already saw it. But yeah, the idea is to call the finder and think about, okay, what am I testing? I'm testing a finder that, it doesn't matter how it's called, but the important thing about this finder is that it cannot return users that are not in the list of users or the single user that I passed in the options, right? So I get the result, I get all the user IDs from the result again, pass it to array, try to get the unique values of that array, hopefully it's only one, and then I just assert that in effect it was only one. Yes, that's the mistake. And I will leave the mistake there just to see how it fails. It will fail with a notice because yesterday we didn't test if the options had the user passed. So I'm going to call PHP unit test case model table questions. And need to configure my database. App.php test localhost root. Oops. Database changing reward test, and that should work. There you go. As you can see, that's pretty odd. That's actually pretty odd. Mark, don't you find it a bit odd that I'm getting a notice as a notice and not as a PHP unit error? That's very good. Maybe I should. Maybe have an outdated version of PHP unit. Where have been? You got the same? It's going to take a couple minutes. Where is PHP unit? Well, anyway, not gonna spend much time in it. We have two errors that we need to solve. One is obviously this. Under a newer version of PHP unit, I think, you get this notice as a failure. Actually, it's an E here. And after you solve that issue, you will see your test failing. I'm just going to solve both. I'm going to go to find my user, and I'm going to test if the user is actually there. So if empty options user, what do you think we should do? Throw an exception. Throw new invalid argument exception. So let's test again. And I have that as I expected it to happen. So I'm going to duplicate the case in the questions here. This is my happy case. This is my not so happy case. So I'm just going to do this and add some. This, I'm going to add expected exception, invalid argument exception. So test that failing to pass a user will throw exception. I'm going to comment this for now. I have one test passing, that's good. And now the other. Find the user, rename it to error. And now here, I actually can pass user one. And I have null. Let's see what the error is. I think I have pajama still. There you go. Oh, it's a user ID, sorry. We did not select the user here, so I just want the user ID. And there you go. We have two. Who managed to complete the example? Raise your hand. You did? Good. So I'm going to give you time for doing the other. you need to do exactly the same. But instead of executing the query was implicitly executed here when I tell it extract something from it. So instead of executing the query, I'd need you to at least test that there is a condition inside saying user equals something. Let me know if you need help, or let me know if you don't want to do it, so we don't waste everyone's time. Okay, just to receive some feedback, let me know that you will do it. Thank you. Okay, someone just asked, what is hydrate for? I'm not sure if anyone remember in Jorge's slides that he had something called hydrate in the query. Do you remember? Yeah. And do you understand what that is? No? So I'm gonna use the console to show you what the difference is. Yeah, another bad example. Okay, so do you remember yesterday this? Table find, Boolean questions, and then I call to array. If I bar dump that, you will see that I get an array of entities. Right? Sound familiar to you? Yes? Okay. If I do hydrate, that actually means I don't want entities. I kind of want the result to look like cake 2. I want arrays. So if I say hydrate false, and then get the result to array, you can see it's plain arrays.
So if you don't put the 2i, what do you get?
If I what? If I don't have to array, you will get the result set, which is not executing the query. Sorry, you just get the query. If you call all, you get the result set. The query has been executed, but the results has not been actually fetched from the database. So you just get the result set object. The result set object can be converted using any method from the collection, for example, to array. And you get that. Is that clear? Okay. So his question is, what would be the use case for not hydrating? Why would you not want a collection of entities? That's a good question. That's why the default is hydrate the entities.
The other way around.
Yeah. Why would you not want it? Well, there are some valid use cases. For example, imagine that you have a shell that needs to iterate over 10 millions of rows, and you have absolutely no interest in any of the methods of the entity. You just want the data. I just want to collect, for example, the total of all orders and print it to a PDF file. I have absolutely no interest in any method of the entity. So it's much, much, much faster to not hydrate the entities and get the raw results from the database.
Would that mean you wouldn't have any data which was a calculated method?
You would not have any calculated method.
So you would have to calculate what it
did. Exactly. Yeah. So you can think about it as KPHP 2. You get arrays and the rest is your problem.
It's not that dangerous because you may assume maybe that the fields
are... It is dangerous and it's a conscious choice. And that's why you have the method saying, I do not want this. It's my responsibility from now on. So yeah. If you want arrays but based on an entity, you can just call map on it. So let me see if there's any way that I don't need to break new line. I'm just gonna do this, then map function row return row to array. That's the entity to array method. And then finally I call to array of the whole thing. And you get exactly the same result, but you also get the virtual properties from the entity. But it's like double opposite, right? You first get an array from the database, you hydrate it, and then back. Yeah, there are use cases, of course. But you just have to be conscious of what it entails. You have a question? I said before that what it just did, getting the normal entities, mapped into array, is like double work, because what Cake does is brings the array result from the database, creates the entity, and you're telling it again, I want the array. But it has an advantage, which is you get the correct types, for example, and you get the virtual properties and everything else. Has anyone finished the assignment? Yes? Is it difficult? I'll take that as a no, or as I don't care. Sure. I'll give you this as inspiration. This is a lazy man version of unit chases without touching the database. Not a fan of it. A lot of people are super fan of not touching databases and not touching anything external in tests. Personally, I think it has more value, functional tests and system tests, than pure functional tests, because I often find that unit tests are just a reverse mode copy-paste of the code that you already made. As you're not doing, very few people is doing test-driven development, not the test first. People what do is they code and then just copy-paste the code and just grab around some assert equals, which is defeat the purpose of a test. But if you're into that, you have a way to do it. Basically, what I did is I generated a new instance of a query, added the function, the conditions and the state that I expected to exist in the query, and then called the actual method and asserted that both queries are exactly the same. Not exactly as in the same object, but that they were constructed in the same way. Any question about this? Without the apply function option, this actually will help you discover a feature of queries. Without it, I get an error. It says that the query has an option called user one. What this is that this is the actual call to the finder method. And result is still a query. So I can say result, let me just debug it, debug result get options. And I will get user equals one. So that's actually very useful, for example, for behaviors. If you say you have a behavior called soft delete, and you want to tell the behavior, hey, don't run soft delete on this, you can pass an option to the query, and the behavior can read that option using get options and interpret that in any way that the behavior wants. So it's important in my test that I assert that the option existed. Make sense? Not 100%? Anyone else is not 100% sure what options, apply options do? What lines? I have the two first, okay. Okay, this one is creating a new query object, empty one, and set up to work with the questions table. The second one, let me add more lines. This one is doing exactly what the finder method does. So I'm just asserting that the query was built correctly. Not very useful, but. And this one here is asserting that at the end, the query in its internal state should have an option called user one. Why is this useful for? I can tell you. Let's create a feature. Let's create a let's create a behavior. Have anyone created a behavior here before? Yes? Okay, so let's create a behavior. Actually, I'm gonna bake it. Console cake bake behavior boundary. There you go. I have a boundary behavior now. Oh, this is test, sorry. So I'm going to create this behavior. And what my behavior will do is public function before find, it gets a query, actually gets event and the query and the options. So what I'm going to do is here, I'm going to apply to the query. Just return, I need to return it, query. I'm just going to apply to the query user ID equals 1. Public function. Yep. Thank you. And I'm going to ask to the questions table, to the initialize function, add behavior boundary. So now, with this new behavior, every time I do a function call, it will append end user ID equals 1. So I'm going to test that in my console. This one, and I want to use BJ. There you go, and let me see, I'm missing it. Not sure that it was actually called. And that I'm actually using the correct table. Yes. B for find by A. Let's try that. Actually, let me try this. There you go. So if I do this, I get everything, only those that were created by user one. Now, how do I tell the behavior, please do not act on this query? Okay, what I can do is, if if not empty, it also works with the options array, but I want to show that the query get options no boundary, then just return. There you go. And I get all the users, and it's not filtered anymore by that. So do you get this? I can also do it like this. I can remove this from here, and from another place, could be another custom finder, somewhere, someone calls apply options, no boundary, true, and I get exactly the same result. If I say false, I will get that. Yeah.
You've got options.
It's the same. Actually, options is a copy, is the result of calling get options before calling the method. It's just a shorthand that you have it as a param. But the reason that it's there is because you could use it from anywhere in the code, the apply options, and get options as well. It doesn't have to be in a callback. Exactly. So back to our unit testing. Let's talk a bit about mocks. Who know what mocks are? Raise your hand. Someone explain to me. Justin already talked. Don't know all the names, but guy in the black t-shirt, you raise your hand. Yes. Your name is?
Robert.
Exactly. So a mock is a stop or a double of an object that can be replaced seamlessly. The application does not need to know that you are replacing that object with something else. But instead of being the full class with all the methods, it's something that you can tweak, you can tune, you can change to expect something to happen to it. For example, that a method was called, that that method received some arguments, or that the method was never called, or to change the construction params. There are plenty of things you can do with mocks. So I want you to, before using mocks, that someone kind of come up with a reason why anyone would ever need mocks.
External API call?
An external API call, that's a good idea.
If you're testing your behavior, you want to mock the table you're attaching it to, because you're not testing the table, you're testing the behavior.
For example, yes. Another one, yes.
Optimizing your tests so that you don't make too many database calls.
For example, if you're going pure unit style, you don't want to call external objects. So in the unit testing philosophy, you just want to focus on testing the object and its methods. So you choose what your unit is. A unit could be a class, a unit could be a method, a unit could be a range of methods. But if you select that is your unit, then your unit should not be touching other stuff that you cannot control directly. A good idea, for example, is an external API. If you're testing something that needs to read from the Twitter stream, and you try to run the test, and Twitter is slow, or you're in a plane, or you're testing an API that you have limited amount of calls per day, you might run into trouble, right? Or for example, if you're testing integration with a GitHub API, and you're testing that your plugin does create a repository correctly, you will actually not want to start creating, deleting repos or posting comments like crazy, right? You would actually mock that class or that method that does the dangerous thing that you do not want to be executed automatically every time you run the test. So Jorge created a behavior called notify owner. And he has this method here that every time you save a question, it will send an email. Do you see any problems with that? What would be the problem? Every time you save in your test, you will have like 100 unread emails. That's not going to make mailbox happy. So what can we do? We can mock. We can definitely mock a method. So I'm going to give you the basic of mocking by extracting. I'm not sure there's a slide for this. Nope. But I'm going to go through the methods that a mock it in, like a creating mocking entails. For creating a mock, you would usually do two different things. One could be using the mock builder, which is a function inside PHP unit. So you just call this get mock builder, my class with all the namespaces, get mock. That just creates a mock that did not call the constructor, and that calls the constructor and has every single method in the class completely removed. The methods can be called, of course, with the arguments you pass, but every method will do nothing and return null. If you want to change this behavior, you can call, well, set methods, and you pass an array of methods that you only want to redefine. For example, the method that sends the email. Set constructor, which is what constructor parameters should be passed once the mock is instantiated. Or if you do not want the constructor to be called because it does plenty of things, for example, if it is a connection adapter to the database and you don't want the connector to call the database, you just disable the original constructor and problem's gone. And same for disable original clone, it will basically just override the clone double underscore clone method. So once that we create a mock, we have a list of matchers that we can use for asserting that stuff happened inside the mock. One is, what you need to do is actually call specs on the mock. That's a new method that the object will get. So if you have, for example, a query, the mock of a query, you will now have query specs. So the new object will have a specs method. And this expects method, which is called a matcher, or receive matchers, can receive any, which is, it will be called or not, but if it's called, do this, if it's called at the first time, at the second time, at the third time, at the fifth time, or is at least once, the method was called, it doesn't matter if it's called 1,000 times, but it should be called at least once. It's called never. It's very useful if, for example, you want to test that a mail was not sent under certain conditions. And this once is like only once. It is called, but if it's called more than once, that means that there is an error. You don't want an email to be sent more than once for the same operation. I'm going to stop here so I'm not just talking in the air. Let's test our behavior. Notify. So can anyone give me a strategy that I can use? To test this method? I don't want the email to be sent. I just want to test that I'm using the framework correctly. I know that KPHP works. I know it sends the email. I could actually add later, at a later point, a integration test that actually sends emails. But in this case, I only want to test that I use the framework correctly. What strategy should I take? Mark the email. Okay. So how do I mark this? So basically, one typical approach is that you either inject a instance of the email that is already prepared to the behavior, or you go the lazy way. I'm going to go the lazy way today, and you redefine another function that you can mock. It basically just abstracts, that's what dependency injection does, or containers do, just abstract the new keyword. It's the main problem in any object-oriented language when you want to test. So instead of doing this, you just do that. So I repeat, this is not the only way. This is a very fast way to do it. Another way would be to inject at construction time, or by a setter, or whatever other technique, the instance of the email. So now that I have the email, I'm going to create the test. I think it's already here, notify. The test is not there, but I can create it. Just copy. So what I'm going to do here is I'm going to create a new behavior using get mock notify owner behavior, and so this is the simplest way you can create a mock, get mock. It will mock all the methods. That's not what we want, but it will mock all the methods. In this case, I only want to mock get email. Email. Okay? So one problem is that I need to pass the full namespace to get mock. So I'm going to do that. Oops. It's import, so it's E. Forgot my shortcut for that. Oh yeah, there you go. So I add the full namespace to that for creating the mock. And now we have access to that here. public function test after save send email. So I'm going to test that. I'm also going to use cake. Where is the email, by the way? Email here. So this is called boundary. It's not boundary, it's behavior. Behavior expects, how many times should I expect an email to be created? Once. And I need to tell it what method will be expected is get email. What will it do? Well, it needs to return an instance of an email. So I'm going to create an instance of an email here. Email. And I only need to mock the send method. So the email is actually not sent. You can do that. That would be the case that you want to test the body of the email, for example. So you want to get everything that it generated and test that it had the correct variable set in the template. That's completely valid. In my case, I only want to test that it was sent. I'm gonna save time and only do that. But yeah, you can be as specific as you want. So I'm gonna do this and then call the behaviors after save. This behavior after save. It receives an event. It receives a entity and options. So the entity, I need some table as well. Table, it's a new table, just a new table. Actually, I think I can import it here. Yeah, gonna do that. CakeORM table. And the entity is table new entity. And I'm missing what? Oh yeah. And I need an event. New event. Has a name called after save. That's not important, but just to be consistent. Okay, and what else is here? D the entity ID must exist. Event, sorry, entity ID equals 1. So let's call this and see what happens. PHP unit test, test case, model behavior, notify owner. There you go. Oops. I didn't rename. What? The what, sorry? What? Oh yeah, I saw why. Sorry about that. I was doing it in the other class. There you go. I have something. The behavior construct must be an instance of table, not given. Okay, I can fix that. Just gonna do this. So the second param of getMock, and this is where you start thinking, maybe I should use a query builder, the mock builder. But well, I'm still lazy. I'm gonna just pass a table here as the first argument of the constructor, and try again. And here I need to use this table. Okay, so the next error is line 26. Table is not fine, yeah. There you go, next is array given. I know, but that's actually correct, yeah. I thought it received an array inside an array. And schema collection, just pass some dummy schema to the table. Find the question schema, question fixture. Actually only care about one column, maybe this one. And yeah, I actually don't care about the rest. Bye bye. There you go. So incorrect number of primary key values, exactly 1, got 0. Where? I need the... Well, I'm getting into trouble just because I didn't want to touch the database. Yeah. I can fix that. Just need to pass the correct data to the table. What? Expected 1, what's 0? Okay, I'm just going to create a new table. Just going to use table registry. And of course, I will need fixtures. Get questions. And then let's go to questions. Test.php. I'm going to get some fixtures. Okay. So now the table registry is not found. Table registry. Okay, now I'm lost. in line 25 of notify owner behavior, I get, oh, okay, it's the owner table. What is this? Oh, it's because it's users. Yeah, okay, I was completely lost. So I just need to import users. User. Mm-hmm. Just debug here. What this actually is. It's users, it's trying to get the users, and from users it's trying to get entity owner field, which is user ID, and I have not passed it. That's all, the only problem. That's what happens when I don't read the code. Entity user ID equals one, and okay, invalid email, blah, blah, blah. That's in notify owner behavior, line 27. So we reached here, finally. The problem is that my fixture is incorrect. It has as email, Loring Ipsum. So I need to go find my user fixture. And where it says email, I just put something. Right? Okay. So at least something is passing, but what is passing? The only thing that is passing is that it expected once to get the email. But it also need to expect once that the email was sent. Basically, is it expecting any? Well, it's sent with something here. So I'm actually just going to add with and add something super dummy here so it can tell me what it's, oops, what it's doing. And it's telling me that this is a text that it should expect here. And now it passes. So I'm basically testing now the after find that it sends an email and that the email has as body this. Does that make sense? Okay. So something that you can use inside with in this function, instead of just passing one value, you can also call this anything, so expect that it was called with anything, or this equal to, so what the argument gets is equal to what is whatever you pass inside that function. Is null or is false or is true or contains. So I'm gonna actually assert, for me the only thing that matters is not the text, but the URL. So I'm going to say, assert that the first param contains questions view one. That's not good. That a traversable contains is that a traversable? Okay, apparently contains is not what we think it is. I think it's a string contains. Exactly. Any questions about this? So, let me see what we can do now. Okay, I think it's enough for mocking. It's very dense material. If you want to see a lot of, or a wide range of usages of mocking, you can go to the KPHP core tests, just navigate them, and you will find plenty of examples of how mocks are used. That's basically how I started coding. I was looking at the tests of other projects and saying, oh, that's how they do it. And then actually that gives you great insight of how the code works in isolation. To finish the topic about mocks, there's another method that you can call on a mock, which is will. So with and will. And you can tell it that will return value true. So this is important sometimes because you need to mock things correctly. If you mock things incorrectly, for example, the send method is supposed to return a string. Actually, it's supposed to return a string. So if you just let it be and do not set the return value, if the method that you're testing relies on the return value of that mock, then it will probably fail. So we use it here, because we actually needed it. But you have here a list of all the things that you can do in will. You can return a value. You can return directly one of the arguments, the first argument, the second argument of the function that was called. On consecutive calls is a map. It's kind of hard to figure out how that works. But it's basically a map where you say, the first time you will get this as argument, and you will return this. The second time, you will receive this as argument, and you will return that. Or throw an exception if you want to simulate, for example, that you're connecting to GitHub and there's no network. So you throw an exception from the library you're using, like not found exception or could not connect exception, and then see how your code reacts to that behavior. Or just return a callback, which is very handy. It will not actually return a callback, but it will call the anonymous function that you put inside. You will get all the arguments of the function, and you can implement something inside. You can call assert inside, you can do a lot of logic, and then return the final thing that the function will get. We did this. And Let's stop here the topic of custom finders, of mocking. Do any one of you want to see anything else about testing, unit testing, or integration testing, or whatever related to PHP unit?
There better be more people.
There better be more people. I already vouched for your book. Yes? Okay.
Good practices on, I haven't read his books, I still need to.
Okay, well, for me, it's a matter of personal opinion. As I said before, I like unit testing, but not taken to the extreme, because you usually end up just copy-pasting the code and then just putting some assert equals around. I'm guilty of that, and I see so many people do that, and then finally you deploy the code and you have a bug there, and no one has an idea while you have 100% coverage and everything is passing, but you still have a bug. Well, because you didn't think about the test. You just implemented the code and put it a lot of assert equals around it. So, just in hindsight, I see that KPHP wants you somehow to use more integration testing than unit testing. Because, for example, model tests touch the database and you're encouraged to assert on the result of the find instead of that the query was implemented correctly. And controller tests are 100% or almost 100% integration tests. You're testing that when you call a controller function, it will do all its job, it will create a view, and you get the view back. And it will probably also touch the database and store stuff there. And there are other type of tests, which is system testing, which is maybe not controlled by KPHP itself, but you can, for example, use something like Selenium. You would probably have a separate project for that will visit your page and assert that your page looks correctly or behaves correctly. Where to find the balance? That depends on your project. For example, if you're doing a library like KPHP, we do a lot of unit testing. We need to do that because we are providing separate components or separate classes for specific stuff. We don't care if you use this or that or this other thing or how your data looks like. You just have to work for every case. We also have integration tests for all the framework itself. For example, the ORM works on itself. If you take the Cake ORM outside and you use it in Symfony, it will work. But we have also other classes that depend on the ORM to make like a full stack framework, for example, the form class. So we have tests that test that even though I have no ORM, the form helper works, but with the ORM, it also works correctly. That would be an integration test. So as I said before, it depends on your project. I tend to favor integration tests in live production database projects. Any other question? Nope. Okay. Let me see. Console cake server. The work that you did with Twitter Bootstrap is not here, right? You did not push that.
No.
Okay, well, that's fine. No, that's fine. It's not actually what I needed to present. It's just like I didn't see the new layout. Okay, so let's jump to the next topic, which is routing and creating a REST API, which will touch how to manipulate entities or how to change some entity properties or methods to make your API look like you expected. Raise your hands if you have greeting an API or some sort of service that does not return just HTML. Good. So, those that raise your hand, why would you build an API instead of just producing HTML? And if you have done it, what are the challenges or the difficulties of creating an API?
Benefit is to only get the raw data instead of taking the trail, like taking the trails
Okay. One of the benefits, as you said, is that you get the raw data. It doesn't have to be raw. It's more or less so that you can expose your application as a type of database, so to speak. So your application will expose some methods and some endpoints that people can use to retrieve or store data specific to a domain. In this case, it's a questions and answers application. In the case of Twitter or tweets, in the case of GitHub or your repositories, comments, pull requests, etc. Right? Even though you can browse the web page, like GitHub page, and find all those features there, they also allow for a way to programmatically access to those features without having a human intervention or a very complex bot clicking on all the buttons correctly. Right? Another advantage of having an API is having alternate ways to build your interface. For example, you could have a JSON API or JSON representation of your data. It doesn't have to be an API, like full stack. But by having that, you can, for example, use Backbone or Angular to build your interface instead of just building your interface in pure PHP. We'll have a talk from Rosina during the conference on how to build interfaces using Angular. Looking forward to that. So we're going to get a bit ahead of time by preparing our application to serve the data that Rosina can use for her interface. So cool. We want to expose questions, at least, let's just focus on questions. We want to expose it as JSON. So something that a lot of frameworks do, and we do too, is just by adding .json at the end of a request, you will supposedly get a JSON document as if it were a file inside the system. In this case, we get an error because we haven't done anything. We haven't told KPHP to do anything about it. So this is what I'm going to do now. So we go to routes, PHP, inside config. And you see how the router works. It has some routes here. It has one for the home page, one for a pages controller, and fallbacks. Fallbacks is basically, as documentation says, two routes. One is controller, or controller action, and some params. You can at any time remove this if you don't need it anymore. That would be the case that you have defined all the routes in your system and you want like super fine-grained control of what happens and you don't want people to access stuff that even though there are controller functions, you don't want them to access them in any way. I'm going to leave that for now. And I'm going to tell KPHP to also convert the question controllers, controller, to a resource. Not sure if without the S. Yeah, it's with the S. So what it does, what resources does, is it will create five or six routes, cannot remember. One is slash questions, the other is slash questions ID that you can access through post, get, patch, put, and delete. Patch is like a put or like a post, but it was envisioned as you send only a few fields or partial data, and it will be applied like a patch on top of what it already existed. Because theoretically, post or put will should completely replace the data. So if you send only a few fields, then only those few fields will be stored, or an error will be returned. It's not how everyone follows the specification of HTTP, which was envisioned in the beginning for documents, not for what we do now. But yeah, someone thought that patch would be an ideal new method to overcome that theoretical issue. And the other thing that we need to do, and you usually do it at the beginning of the scope function, is you call routes extensions, and you say that yes, JSON is allowed.
Mm-hmm. In Cake 2, the routes were matched procedurally. Is that still the case?
More or less. It depends on this param here. It will first match that part. If there's something that is more specific, for example, I say that the scope is slash questions, it will start there because it's faster. And most.
Speaking to you and Christian, when you were talking about organizing your routes by most visited page first, to allow
routes. Exactly. Well, that's what it does. And if nothing matches in the other scopes that are more specific, then it jumps to the general scope with a slash, and then it just falls back if you have a fallback. So more or less is in that order. So now I can reload this, but nothing happens. It just accepted the .json, but I'm not seeing any JSON. I need to tell KPHP that it should listen for alternate response or accept header and generate a different response. And that is quite easy. You should just go to your app controller and add a new component called request handler. That's step one. And then you go to your questions controller. And instruct Cake what variables that you set. In this case, I only set questions, but what variables should be serialized to JSON. In this case, only questions. I reload, and I have a JSON API, at least for bringing my questions back. Wasn't that easy? Yes. One cool thing about KPHP is that it talks multiple formats. So you can also say, I'm very into JSON, into XML, because I'm some sort of weird dude. So you can say the same for XML, and you get an XML format. Let's just stick to JSON, which is what the cool kids do now. Okay. I can see plenty problems with my API right now. Perhaps not problems, but stuff that annoy me. And is that it's exposing too much data, too much internal structures. It shouldn't be telling, OK, this is my database, here you have it. Right? You should somehow keep it to what is important for your API. So for example, if you have a question type ID, that's not important because you already have a question type. You shouldn't repeat that data. You should just say, well, my question type is this. It doesn't have it has ID 100,000. Nobody cares. Unless you expose an API to change the question types, of course. So we need ideas. People that already know Cake 3 or that know hacky ways to remove or change or alter that thing. Oh, I have another. This is unencrypted because I started with an unencrypted database. I haven't implemented login or anything. But yeah, I'm pretty sure you shouldn't be sending the password to in your API. So ideas. Mark, you're so smart. So I can go to the question entity, question.php, the entity. And as we have an accessible array, that means to prevent mass assignment, which Jorge explained before, I can also have a hidden array. I'm actually going to start from the thing that annoyed me the most, which is in user, in user PHP. Protected, hidden. The thing that annoys me the most is that password should not be there. So you do this, and password is not there anymore.
So the hidden is only what
for exporting the entity to a format. Could be JSON, and probably array.
When you serialize or?
Yes, when you serialize it.
So is password still selected from the data?
It is still selected. That was another way of solving the problem, which is not selecting the data. I would most of the time go that way. Or like foolproof or bulletproof is to, no matter if I make a mistake selecting the data, I definitely do not want the password to be shown. I don't want to show the email, otherwise they will get spam. I don't want to show the role. I don't want to show created or modified. And an organization ID, not. Right? What else should we remove from question?
Foreign keys.
Okay. So let's copy this to question. So I don't want user ID. Or question type ID, or the I think that's it. Okay, it's looking a bit better. One thing that I don't want is to repeat question type ID1 boolean description ID1 boolean description ID1 boolean description for the question type, right? Ideas.
If the API describes itself, we should have a link to the endpoint for question type and the ID.
Oh, that's a good idea. We could do that. But I don't. What I definitely don't want to do is show ID, name, description in every single one. What could I do? You already learned a technique yesterday to do it. We could use that. I was expecting someone to say, yeah, I learned that yesterday. I was not asleep. I was wrong. So something you can do is remember the getters, virtual property getters. Yes? So I'm going to call this something else, just for fun. I'm going to call this question. I'm going to hide question type. I'm just calling type. This is a way to do it. You can do it other ways. It's protected, sorry. Okay, so if I reload, nothing is going to happen. But I can tell the entity that it has virtual properties. And now I have, in all my questions, a type with only the name. I don't have a resource to manipulate the question type, so I really don't care if anyone can access it. So I just hide the information and put it as, it's just a Boolean, Boolean type of question, or a opinion type of question. And remember the full name stuff from user? Now I have full name. I don't have last name on those, but yeah. You get the idea. You could even just hide first and last. And that's it. For example, that user, instead of showing an array to show the you can do something like this. For example, in question, virtual, you can say creator, and then you have a getter for creator.
But can you grab the virtual field from user?
Yeah, of course you can do that. You can say user, full name. This should be creator. And you have more. Just going to remove this. I don't care. No, they're just hidden when the entity is serialized. It doesn't affect in any way forms, if I'm not mistaken.
It's for to JSON and to
array. Okay. You can also, on the fly, for each entity, call add, remove virtual properties or hidden properties. So, for example, if you're debugging and you want to see the full array, then just set hidden to null or to empty array. I have the impression that we're close to a break. Is that correct? In half an hour. Okay. Great. So let me see if I have here. There you go. Headers is don't. There you go. No. Okay, it's buggy. Let me use another one. Problem is that it doesn't fit the screen. So the content type, I need the accept. Content type, authorization headers. I accept application JSON and I get. I'm not setting the correct header, am I? No, it's gonna work. I'm gonna use curl. It doesn't look okay here. Hey, sir, I mean. So curl. Header accept application JSON. This URL. Am I missing anything? It's application JSON, right? Or is text JSON? It's application JSON. Okay, well, I may not want to use this feature right now. I'm going to use this for now until I figure out what I'm calling wrong or what I did not set up wrong. I'm going to check that during the break. So, okay, what we want to do now is to be able to create questions and edit questions. Okay? So let's implement first adding a question. If I go here to add, I get this. Oh, another thing that bothered me about my API is that I don't want questions here. I want kind of like a neat data and success, like Facebook style. So I'm going to do that. That's in questions controller. Not here. Questions controller. I'm going to tell that. Not remember the syntax. I think it's here. There you go. Now it's called data. And I'm going to set success as well. I also need to serialize success. Set success true. So you have data and success somewhere. Oh yeah, I need to alias it, sorry. I'm missing what? Oh yeah. Yeah, that's true. There you go. So now I have a template that looks like Facebook, which is not the greatest API, but but it kind of sets the trend. So okay, let's try to add questions. If I go to add, I will need to set a user, I will need to set a text, I will need to set a question type, I will need to set, optionally, some text. So I'm going to keep it simple, I'm just going to use send user, text, and question type. So here, I'm just going to add some data, this is user ID equals 1. I should actually use this. No, it's fine. User ID 1 and text equals hello, hello world. And what else? That it, right? And the question type. D. Without this. Also equals to in this case. If I do this, I should see my questions that I have a hello world, right? I didn't get any response back because I haven't told KPHP that it should respond in that endpoint. But at least it knows that when I post to that questions endpoint with some data, it should do exactly the same that it does with the form. So one of the questions that we get recurrently is, how do I make a controller function work the same for HTML and a API? What would be the answer to that? I think you have to face that. I know the answer. No? The answer to that is absolutely nothing. You already saw that it works. Right? You just need to respond with whatever variables you want to set back. So if it's a user that you're... Oh, actually, yes, you have to do something. It's I here. There you go. You should get a location header, which is extremely annoying. So we should prevent somehow redirection if it's JSON. So I'm going to tell you my super hack. Why did you laugh? Well, it's not a hack. There are plenty of ways to do it. One is to abstract this piece of code away, the one that saves, sets a message, and redirects. And I tend to do that. And the other is the super hack. Which is change this function to not redirect. I'm not going to do that because it's a super hack. So I'm going to abstract this piece of code to do exactly what I want, which is save something, on success, notify the user and redirect, but if it's JSON API, then don't redirect, but set some sort of variables, right? So I'm going to do this. Let's actually add it. I need to do it in add. Just going to call return. Is it return that I need? Just going to call this save and notify. And notify question. Let me just create the method here. Protected function save and notify. And then just call it question for now. So doing this should work. You just need perhaps another if here. We can unnest it afterwards. We can clean the code. If response, we can clean the code in a few minutes. So if it's a response, just return the response. Otherwise, continue. We can probably still have the same behavior here. I actually have new mail. Yeah, I know. I haven't changed anything, but I just wanted to test that my function still works. What I found funny is that the behavior is working. It's sending me emails. So here, I'm gonna do the flow, like normal flow. Response equals this. Just gonna clean up the code a bit. So if there's a response, then all is good, and return the response. If it's not good, then the error will happen. Now, I just test that I still have the same behavior. 3, that works. We have hello world 3. Haven't broken anything. I'm going to struct this here and say that response or success, let's just call it success, true. Don't need that. Just going to be a bit cleaner. Success equals this, which is actually the entity. So if success and not this request, accepts, application JSON, then I do something with the response. If there's a response, do that. I have an error and I cannot see it. Oh yeah, thank you. If there's a response, do that. Otherwise, this, but if there was a success, I'm just gonna do it here. If there was successful, it was successful, and I'm just gonna repeat myself, and does accept application JSON, so just return, right? Actually, instead of just return, I'm just gonna set this set data success, or actually question, which is the thing that got saved, and this set success true, this set, just calling way too much set, but you get the drift, serialize data and success, and here, if there is a response, do that. Otherwise, do the other thing. Cool.
And,
so
and above as well.
Thank you.
Work, very
I'm very consistent, even in my mistakes. So hello world 4. Oops. Have a small problem here. Undefined value response, that's true. Response is false. There you go. Oh well, I can avoid that by just calling here this. That's it. Hello world 5. And now I have Whoops, I have an error with an API response, sorry. Okay, this happens. I mean, that notice that you see, it looks ugly. It's because I have not set up correctly this accept part. So it's returning HTML instead of a JSON error. I'm going to check that out during the break. Okay, what was the notice? An entity trait to array JSON serialized JSON encode. Ah, okay. It's a type. That's for the question. So I'm gonna tell. Remember our hidden properties and virtual properties. As they are now globally configured, you probably don't want them to appear everywhere. Or you want to append all the data that is needed for it to show. I'm just going to hide it for now. Question. Hidden. Is hidden field? Mark? To configure hidden properties? Is hidden properties? Just none? Sorry, it's virtual properties. What do you want? Six. There you go. So I have no location redirection anymore, and I have the correct data that I have posted. So this pattern repeats so much that you can usually put it in app controller, make it part of your bake process, or you can use a dynamic scaffolding plugin like the CRUD plugin to do that for you. So if you have used CRUD in the past, the CRUD plugin, that pattern is extracted to basically one call, which is do your edit stuff. Because anyone that has dealt with CRUD operations have noticed how much the same code is repeated everywhere. Like there are perhaps one or two lines that are different, like for configuring this or that, but most of the boilerplate is always the same. I need to fetch the entity, I need to call validate, I need to call save, if it's good, this do this, if it's not, do that, if it's JSON, do that. All of that is abstracted inside a plugin that is called CRUD. It's Friends of Cake, CRUD. CRUD, just CRUD. The branch Cake3 already works. And here you have documentation. I just wanted to show like very quickly. How do you use CRUD? Let me see if there's an example, like a quick example. Yeah, well, basically, it's this. You just either configure it or call a method. You say, I want to have CRUD. It's like scaffolding. And you say, well, the actions that I allow to be CRUD, to be executable, are index, post, delete, you name it. You have an array. And basically what the plugin does is that code that Bake generates plus the pattern that we have just implemented, which is extracting that piece of code so that it can be used for a JSON API automatically, without you having to extract the code and prevent the redirection or have to hack the redirect method to do anything in particular. So I really recommend it, or recommend to check this plugin out because it saves a lot of time. Sorry. Yeah. Any questions about this? This usually, if you don't want to use the CRUD plugin, or you want just to reinvent the wheel and do what the CRUD plugin does, you can take this piece of code here and put it inside a component and just call the component You can just call that method. So you have a reusable piece of code that can be used to save an entity and return different stuff depending on the result of the operation and the accept header. Any questions about this? Okay, good. Another way to implement this is to append a listener to the controller before redirect, and in before redirect, just prevent the redirection to, so it doesn't happen. So the location header is not changed, and some other data is appended to the response. That's another way to do it. Okay. So now I want you, how much time do we have? 10 minutes. So in 10 minutes, I want you to, what is example? It's in user controller. No, it's in answers. So I want you to create an endpoint, an API endpoint, that will list a question with all its answers and try to modify it a bit so the answers look correctly. For example, that the foreign keys are not shown and the creator of the answer is there and the time of the answer is correctly formatted, all that. So I think in 10 minutes it can be done. Just let me know if you need help.
José. I'm teaching you some crazy shit.